Fasting has been done for centuries all through Europe and has been well known to be a trigger to bring about healing processes in the body. So what I'd like to look at in this presentation is fasting, what it is and the effect that it has on the body. And research is coming out today that is revealing that fasting is doing far more than most people thought. So I'd like to have a look at the different types of fasting. But first of all, what is fasting? Fasting basically, in the dictionary says, absence of food. Now, food is eaten to give nourishment to every cell in our body. So what happens when we don't fast? Now, as I showed you yesterday, when we went inside the cell, here is the cell, and we have the pathways. We looked at the 20-step pathway, and this 20-step pathway gives us 2 units of energy. This is where glucose goes down. The end result of the 20-step pathway is a chemical form of glucose called pyruvate. Pyruvate is the chemical form of glucose that gets fed into the 8-step pathway, and this 8-step pathway delivers to us 36 units of energy because of the presence of oxygen. Whereas this pathway, no oxygen. So this is your glycolytic pathway and this is the mitochondria Krebs cycle pathway. We also looked at the fact that the body also stores glucose like little molecules, just like a little bunch of grapes really. Looks like a little bunch of grapes, but they're little molecules of glucose sitting in the muscle cell particularly, ready to be plucked when no food's coming in. And we also looked at the third place that the liver sends glucose when we eat is as the fat cells. And the fact is that we can go periods of time without eating because we've got these backups. We've got our glycogen stores already in our muscle cell. We've got our fat stores. So we can go periods without eating because there are stores in the background. So what happens when you fast? Well, one type of fasting is absence of food for a period of time. And we look in the Bible when Israel was being challenged, often the king would go through a period of fasting and he'd get all the people of Israel together and they would fast and pray, asking God to intervene because the enemy was too big and too great. And there are some amazing stories of how God did that. But often fasting was chosen. You see, 1,200 calories is required to digest a meal. So when you're not digesting a meal, all that blood and energy is going to other areas. And because the brain is headquarters, capital city of the human body, when you need to do some intense thinking, and I guess when Israel was in trouble and they were praying and pleading with God for wisdom, for intervention, then all their body's energies, well, the body's energies that usually go with digestion, were able to go to brain function, help, clear mind. You see, when they weren't eating, the body started plucking the glycogen stores and started eating up the fat stores. So fasting has been used for that, but fasting has also been used as a way of healing. Healing the body from certain diseases. You see, when you're not digesting, and your brain's not going into intense brain function, the body basically says, wow, this is great. We've got a little bit of extra energy here. We can go to the areas of greatest need. And at our health retreat, our guests go through 2 days of fasting. And in those 2 days of fasting, we give them juices because juices bypass digestion. Well, basically, I think digestion takes about 10 minutes. And what happens when you're bypassing digestion? All that blood and energy goes to areas of greatest need. It can be likened to what happens when you're on holidays at home. When I'm on holidays at home, I go to the areas of greatest need. So every day I sweep the floor, I do the dishes, I make the bed, I wash the clothes. But there are little areas in the house that I look at and I think they can wait. Maybe some papers are piling up in a corner. They can wait. They're not a priority. So when When I have holidays at home, I go to those areas of greatest need. You see, the body knows what to do. It knows how to heal you. God put that amazing process inside the body. And when you're fasting, the body basically says, great, we've got a little bit of extra help now. We can go to those areas of greatest need. And as I often tell our guests at our health retreat, in every single body, the energies are going to a different area. It all depends on the greatest need. But before rest and rejuvenation can happen, the first thing the body has to do is clean house. And we have four organs of elimination we looked at earlier in this series of lectures. We've got our skin, which throws off waste. We've got our urine that's throwing off waste. We've got our lungs that are also throwing off waste. And we've got our colon, which is eliminating the largest pieces of waste. So all the waste is coming out of the body, but there are some areas of waste that are fairly toxic. And the liver, being the project manager, the liver is the one that detoxifies us, or basically is in charge of the detoxification process. And your liver detoxifies you in three ways. So number one requirement is to stop eating. And when you stop eating, the fat stores start to get broken down to give the necessary glucose for your cells to run. But all through our life, when we're confronted with or take in by mouth, by skin, environmental poisons, they always go to the liver. The liver's the project manager. And sometimes these environmental poisons come to the liver and the liver says, this is a nasty, nasty guy. Wrap him up in fat and store him. So in our fat cells, we've got these environmental poisons stored up. And then the person comes to the health retreat and they stop eating and the fat stores are getting broken down to give the glucose that our cells need to run on, and something else a little bit more sinister is being released. It's the fat-soluble toxins. And these fat-soluble toxins that have been building up in our fat cells all our life. And what the liver does, it must break that down to a water-soluble state. That's the only way that it can be released out of the body, is as a water-soluble state. And so the liver does this in three stages. Let me show you. Phase one. Phase one of the liver detox is where the liver takes this fat-soluble toxin, I've made a little symbol to make it a little easier, and it breaks it down to a metabolite. Metabolite simply means the first stage of metabolism or the first stage of breakdown. And this metabolite is more toxic than it originally was. It creates a lot of free radicals. This metabolite is highly volatile. And this metabolite creates a lot of free radicals, and free radicals are damaging to the tissues. And you might make the comment, what's the liver doing? It's just created something worse than it originally was. It's a process. It's like when we clean up the garage. Halfway through cleaning up the garage, it looks 100 times worse than when we started, because we're pulling everything out. Basically, that's what's happening. Now, within 36 hours of going on a fast, phase two kicks in. And in phase two, the liver takes this highly toxic, highly volatile metabolite and joins it together with amino acids. The union of this highly toxic, highly volatile metabolite with the amino acids, it basically joins it together like this. It locks the highly volatile metabolite with amino acids. That creates the water-soluble state. And in a water-soluble state, it can be easily released out of the body. So the symbol for the water-soluble state is a wave in a box. Phase three happens in conjunction with phase two. And phase three is where the liver takes this water-soluble state and basically releases it out via your sweat glands, releases it out via your urine, releases it out via your colon. You see, it is now a water-soluble state and it can be easily released out. This is what science is showing now happens when people fast. Now, your liver has certain needs at these stages. So the needs that the liver has at stage two is antioxidants. You see, this metabolite is very toxic and has the ability to damage us. Well, that's what the free radicals do. Whereas the antioxidants, their nickname is free radical scavengers. They mop them all up. So the most potent antioxidants are beta carotenes. This is why when you fast today, you must have juices. And the most potent beta carotenes is found in your orange coloured vegetables and your green coloured vegetables. So at our health retreats, we give mostly carrot, celery and apple juices. That's 80% carrot, 10% celery, 10% apple. And our celery is dark green because it's come out of my garden. So that carrot, celery and apple juice, very high in beta carotenes to mop up or to help mop up these nasty metabolites while the amino acids come in and join with them to make this safe water-soluble state. Another antioxidant is vitamin C. Vitamin C is not ascorbic acid. Ascorbic acid is only part of vitamin C. Ascorbic acid is like the envelope that's holding all the other nutrients that makes up vitamin C. Have you ever got an envelope in the mail and opened it and it's empty? That's ascorbic acid. You might have heard of Dr. Linnaeus Pauling. He got two Nobel Prizes for his work on vitamin C. It was not on ascorbic acid, it was on the whole C. And the whole C is what you'll find in your fruits and your vegetables. So if you do buy a vitamin C, make sure it has ascorbic acid with bioflavonoids. The bioflavonoids come with the ascorbic acid to make the whole C. Another potent antioxidant is vitamin E. Vitamin E is a fat-soluble vitamin, so you'll find vitamin E in nuts, seeds, grains, legumes. What's also required at phase two is minerals. And minerals are found in that little bit of Celtic salt before every glass of water. Using organically grown fruits and vegetables for the juices is providing the minerals. And with our guests, we give a steam bath every afternoon. At 6 o'clock, they have broth. And broth is a lot of vegetables cooked in a lot of waters for many hours and then strained. So all the minerals out of the vegetables have gone into the water. We even put stinging nettle in our broth. Then it's strained out. The good news is you don't have to eat it. You just get the minerals out in the water. And then we put some Celtic salt in. So we give our guests every evening a broth, which is very high in minerals. Also vitamin B. Vitamin B is required. On our detox program, we always give our guests a vitamin B supplement 3 times a day. What we aim to do is nutritionally support every cell in the body. We aim to nutritionally support the liver to be able to effectively detoxify you, to be able to mop up these nasty metabolites and get them out of your body. Well, what's the needs in phase three? Because amino acids are required. Sorry, this is phase one. Now we're looking at the needs of phase two. So the needs of phase two are protein. Protein is required to supply the amino acids to mop up the nasty metabolites. So when we are running a detox program at our health retreats, we always serve a protein powder, especially day two, because notice what I said, within 36 hours, phase two is kicking in. So definitely by the second day, protein is needed. We use a pea protein, and it's a pre-digested protein, so it's very easily digested in fact, probably again in about 10 minutes, the digestion of the protein drink has been done. So on phase two, when phase two is happening, which is day two of a fast, we supply three protein drinks. So that's 8 o'clock in the morning and 12 o'clock and 4 o'clock in the afternoon. On our detox days, we give five juices, 8, 10, 12, 2, and 4. And so on the second day, it's every second juice gets the protein, and all other juices, we serve a green barley, which is very high in the beta carotenes. What does phase three need? Phase three needs fats. What fats do is they keep the cell nice and supple and allow the process to happen. And so in our protein drinks, we give a little bit of coconut cream. We also put a bit of almond milk in. So the combination of almond milk, coconut cream, and the protein powder, that makes up the protein powder that we give to cope with phase two of the liver detox. This information has only been known since 2002. But as you can see by my illustration this morning, it's important information. We are dealing with more fat-soluble toxins than any generation that's ever lived on planet Earth. The Bible talks about Jesus fasting for 40 days. It was actually a miracle because he didn't drink water for 40 days, and we would not survive that. But all through history, there's stories of people fasting, sometimes for long periods of time, to be able to overcome certain illnesses. But in 2016, going into 2017, we need to be mindful of the three phases of the liver detox. So when you choose to fast, and fasting is an excellent way to give the stomach a rest, the gastrointestinal organs a rest, but it is also a God-designed way to free the system from built-up fat-soluble toxins that are coming into our body all through our life. But all the fasting experts agree today that you are far better to do 2 days of fasting a week or 2 days of fasting a fortnight rather than a long fast. Because if you do a long fast, too many fat-soluble toxins are released, and that will create too many metabolites, and it can make a person quite sick. You see, if all the environmental toxins were to come out of our body right now, we'd basically all be dead. Little by little, the body lets them go. We do 2 days of juicing at our health retreat for a one-week program. Sometimes people come for 2 weeks and they will do a two-day fast on the second week as well. And sometimes we see people go down on the second fast. You see, the first fast, it's going so deep. Second fast, going a little bit deeper. So when a person does start to get sick, we'll often give them a little extra protein. You can see why, because the amino acids are mopping up those nasty metabolites. Someone can get quite sick if they do a water fast, because if they do a water fast, there is nothing to mop up these toxic metabolites, and then there is nothing to join them together to create the water-soluble state that can be easily released out of the body. I was fascinated to read in Florence Nightingale's book that when she found a very sick patient, almost death's door, they responded to two things: beef tea and raw milk. Now, what do beef tea and raw milk both contain? Protein. As I say to our guests, we're not going to give you beef tea and raw milk. They're not very safe today. And we have something superior to that, which is the plant protein. If someone comes and does our health program and does a couple of days on fasting, and they're a Vietnam veteran, or they're a farmer that's had a lot of exposure to chemicals, or maybe a cleaner, we've had some very sick cleaners using chemicals to clean, hairdressers, these are all people that have had a lot of exposure to chemicals, I will often put them on a protein drink every juice. So that's 5 times a day, because I know that what's going to be coming out of them is pretty toxic. And the metabolites can make them quite sick. This also explains why Dr. Atkins was having results. You see, you can't deny this guy was number one. His book was number one on the New York Times best-selling list 4 years running. Most people don't realize his patients had to eat 3 cups of vegetables a day and 1 cup had to be greens. So they were getting a lot of beta carotenes. They were also getting the protein that is necessary. And as a friend of mine who'd been a patient of Atkins, he said, you know, I believe if Atkins would have read the China study, Dr. Atkins would have become a vegetarian. That's quite a statement, isn't it? Because the China study has shown us very clearly the dangers of the animal protein. So only since 2002 has this information been known about the three phase of the liver detox. And as you can see, it is vital information, because if you do go on a fast to bring about healing in the body, it's very important that you nutritionally support your liver, that you nutritionally support every cell in your body so that you can effectively detox, because we don't want you to be sicker when you finished than when you began. It also explains why some people get very sick on the detox. I have known some people to go on a 10-day fast and not get very sick. But you know, I investigated the case and I found out that these people were about 350 pound. They had not had exposure to chemicals through their life. So maybe what they were releasing from their fat stores weren't as toxic as maybe someone else. So this is one of the remarkable things that science is now showing us as to the reason why people are recovering from serious illnesses when they go through a fast. Because a fast could be called a detox. It could be called a cleanse, because as the fat stores get broken up, they are releasing the environmental poisons. And on the first lecture that I gave, where I talked about the true cause of disease and all the little microorganisms, do you remember a lot of those microorganisms, their role on planet Earth are the garbage collectors? So if we've got a lot of garbage in our body, a lot of environmental poisons, it can be a fruitful ground for them to grow. So fasting, if someone does fasting today, my suggestion is only go 2 days. In his book, Dr. Michael Mosley's book, The Fast Diet, he goes a little bit further. And there are quite a few scientists today are showing that fasting affects the brain. And what they are showing is that after not eating for, I think it's 24 hours, so not eating for 24 hours, the brain releases a protein called brain-derived neurotrophic factor. And brain-derived neurotrophic factor is a protein that stimulates neurogenesis. So fasting not only helps to rid our fat stores of built-up environmental poisons, especially as you saw, if you nutritionally support the body, fasting also stimulates the release of the protein, brain-derived neurotrophic factor, which stimulates neurogenesis. Do you know what neurogenesis means? New brain cells. Now, this discovery was made in 1998. Up until that time, it was understood that when the brain cells died, they were gone. And that is true. Once the brain cell dies, it's gone. It cannot regrow. But under the right conditions, brain-derived neurotrophic factor is released, which causes neurogenesis, new brain cells. Isn't that good news? God is so amazing what he has put into our body. And the more science goes deeper and deeper into the human body, the more it finds these most amazing things. God is so merciful. So merciful that he gave us brain-derived neurotrophic factor that can stimulate neurogenesis. I have known people who have been heavily into drugs and alcohol. God has touched their heart. They have opened their heart to him, and now they are no longer drug addicts. They are no longer alcoholics, and they are living for him. And yesterday I gave you this, the The passage in the Bible, Ezekiel 36:36, that the heathen that are left round about might know that I, the Lord God, build the ruined places and plant again that which was desolate. God can do that in the brain with brain-derived neurotrophic factor. Listen to it again, that I, the Lord God, build the ruined places and plant again that which was desolate. For I, the Lord God, hath spoken it, and I will do it. God stands behind every promise. If you have a brain that's not working well because of things that have been done in times past, claim the promise of Ezekiel 36:36. You can claim the promise, but there are also some other things you've got to do. And my suggestion is try a fast one day or 2 days a week. It will stimulate brain-derived neurotrophic factor, causing new brain cells to be developed, no matter what the age. But there are some requirements. Let's have a look at the requirements for the release of brain-derived neurotrophic factor, a fast. So this can be 1 day or 2 days, or it can be another type of fast that Ellen White defines in the Ministry of Healing, and that is having 2 meals a day. For myself, I have breakfast at 7 o'clock, like a king. I have lunch at usually about 1:30, like a queen. And often I do not eat again till breakfast the next day. That's an 18-hour fast. And that is such an easy fast because when we would be the most hungriest, we are asleep. And your stomach's very happy because it gets to sleep when you're sleeping. So the fast can be 1 day, or the fast can be 2 days, or the fast can be the 18-hour fast done every 24 hours. That's a very easy way to do it. And the only way you can go the distance is to have high fiber, and all your plants are high in fiber. Generous amounts of protein. I myself eat legumes every meal. For lunch yesterday, I had, I think they were cannelloni beans. We had squash and carrots baked. We had a big salad. We had some dressings with that. Oh, and we had steamed broccoli. You see, that meal, everything had fiber, generous amounts of protein. And for dessert, we had some walnuts. So legumes and nuts, be careful not to overdo the nuts. And seeds, oh, that's what I also had, pumpkin seeds. And then healthy fats. What are your healthy fats? Your healthy fats are the fats that have not been altered. The most dangerous fats are the heating of the polyunsaturated fats, the margarines, they're the altered fats. We need to be having oil in its raw state. The only oil that can bear heat is coconut oil because it has no empty spots for the heat and the light to be attracted into. It's a saturated fat. So your healthy fats are your nuts and your seeds and your coconut and your olive. Where did I get fats yesterday? I had fats in my nuts and my seeds. I had some olive oil. In fact, the cook had crushed garlic and put it with olive oil. And having talked a lot for the last few days and my throat got a little bit sore, I'm having some raw garlic every meal, and it certainly is helping. Praise God that He gave us herbs. Psalm 104, verse 14, God gave herbs for the service of man. What did I have for breakfast this morning? For breakfast, I had raspberries. I had almonds. I had an orange. There's lots of fiber there. Lots of minerals too. And then I had some rye toast with olive oil. I had crushed garlic on top of that. I said to my husband in the email, I don't think you would want to kiss me at the moment. I'm very, very strong of garlic. So I had garlic. Then I had avocado on top of that. And then I had some red lentils. The avocado and the red lentils on top of the garlic and the olive oil and the rye toast underneath helped to sandwich it. So my breakfast this morning was high in these. I had it at 7 and I know I will not have any hunger till 1 o'clock. Now, my sons, they might have twice what I ate. They might have two slices of toast. They might have two cups. So you see, you play with that depending on your age, your size, your fitness. Unfortunately, it was raining this morning and I couldn't go for my morning run. So what I do is I do the plank. Do you do the plank? Hold the plank and do some Pilates workouts on the floor. We need to be getting the body fit. So every day we must do some sort of exercise. So that is how you can do the 18-hour fast. When you eat like that, it will go the distance. So to trigger a release of brain-derived neurotrophic factor, fast. Another thing that triggers this release is low carbohydrates. This is what the science is showing. Low carbs or low starches. Many Americans in Australia have cereal and toast for breakfast, sandwiches for lunch, pasta for tea. That's almost 100% carbohydrate. We've got to get the carbohydrates down. Now, all grains are high in protein, but they're very high in carb. Whereas your legumes, they are high in protein, but they are medium to low in carbohydrates. And your nuts and your seeds, they're very low in carbohydrates. So to get the carbohydrates down, greatly reduce the grains. That's the best way to get the carbohydrates down. What also causes a release of brain-derived neurotrophic factor is the high intensity interval training. This is running for your life for 30 seconds and having a rest for 2 or 3 minutes and doing that about 6 times. That huge blast of energy causes the blood to start moving very fast, going into all the little extremities, especially the brain. What also causes a release of brain-derived neurotrophic factor is full hydration. The brain cannot function if it's dehydrated. Our brain is a hydroelectric system, so no hydro, and that's water, no electricity. So full hydration, how does full hydration happen? At least 8 glasses of water throughout the day with that little bit of Celtic salt with every glass. And what that does, that Celtic salt with its 3 magnesium, it causes the water to be pulled inside the cell. What also causes a release of brain-derived neurotrophic factor is early nights. What totally blocks a release of the brain-derived neurotrophic factor is eyes. You see, your eyes are an extension of your brain, is eye exposure to technology. And do you remember those hours? That computer, that television has to be switched off before 9. But it's a documentary that you've been waiting to see for a while. Well, because of eye view, because of recording, you don't have to watch it at that time. 9 p.m. and 2 a.m. I went to a lecture by Dr. Agatha Thrash. She's passed now, but she did a mighty work. And someone asked her the question, how often can you afford a late night? She said, oh, about once every 2 years. Got that? Once every 2 years. You almost can't make up for those late nights. So to cause a release of brain-derived neurotrophic factor, make sure you're going to bed early. Number 6, sunshine. Your brain needs sunshine and it gets sunshine through your eyes. So every day, ideally, it's a bit hard in Vancouver at the moment because we've got a lot of rain, but we did have a little bit of sunshine yesterday. As I do this list, have you noticed I'm actually going over the 8 laws of health? And that brings us to another one, and that is things that can inhibit the release is caffeine. The reason why sugar inhibits the release is because it overloads the brain with fuel, alcohol. Also drugs, and the drugs specifically that I'm referring to are the mind-altering drugs, whether they be legal or illegal, and tobacco. Tobacco robs the brain of oxygen. So for various reasons and in various ways, all of these substances inhibit the body's ability to release brain-derived neurotrophic factor. Notice in this cell, now this cell here is in every brain cell, these energy cycles. Notice how much energy we're getting with oxygen compared to a cell that doesn't get the oxygen, very little energy. And so that's where pure air comes into it. If a person's smoking cigarettes, they've got a huge reduction in oxygen going to the cell. And if a person is breathing in moldy air, chemical air, stale air, bad air, it inhibits the brain working properly because we're only getting this much energy instead of that much energy. Isn't it amazing how science is now showing that the 8 laws of health are stimulating a release of brain-derived neurotrophic factor? And when brain-derived neurotrophic factor is released, it causes the state of neurogenesis to happen. That means new brain cells. In Psalm 139, verse 14, the Bible says, I will praise thee, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. So in looking at fasting, we're looking at the liver and how it's able to detoxify us from environmental poisons. We're looking at the release of brain-derived neurotrophic factor when we fast, which stimulates neurogenesis. What I have been talking about is the physical fast, the cessation of food. But the Bible talks about another fast. And this fast, basically, is not food. This fast is talking about the absence of something else. And we will find it in Isaiah 58. And in Isaiah 58, it begins by saying, cry aloud, spare not, lift up thy voice like a trumpet, show my people their transgressions, the house of Jacob their sins. Yet they seek me daily and delight to know my ways, as a nation that did righteousness and forsook not the ordinance of their God. They ask of me the ordinance of justice, and they take delight in approaching to God. Now these people are Christians, yeah? They take delight in approaching to God. But look at the next verse. Then the people have a complaint. They say, wherefore have we fasted, and thou seest not? Wherefore have we afflicted our souls? And they take, thou takest no knowledge. Behold, in the day of your fast, says God, ye find pleasure, and exact all thy labours. God says, behold, ye fast for strife and debate and smite with the fist of wickedness. He says, you shall not fast as you do this day to make your voice to be heard on high. Can you see what God's saying? In the day of your fast, you find pleasure. I'm fasting. Everyone, look. Everyone. Can you see what's happening? God has no pleasure in that. And then God says, is this the fast that I have chosen? To bow down thy soul as a bulrush, to spread sackcloth and ashes under thee? Wilt thou call this a fast, an acceptable day of the Lord? But then God defines it. He said, is not this the fast that I have chosen, to loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke? Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, to bring the poor that are cast out to thine house? That when thou seest the naked, that thou cover him, and turn not thy face from thine own flesh. Then shall thy light break forth as the morning. Thine health shall spring forth speedily. Did you get that? Thine health shall spring forth speedily. Thy righteousness shall go before thee, and the glory of the Lord shall be thy reward. The glory of the Lord? What's the glory of the Lord? Do you know, Moses said in Genesis 33, he says, I beseech you, show me your glory. And God said, no man can see me and live. But he said, hide yourself in the cleft of a rock and I'll pass by you before you. And so then you go over to chapter 34, verse 5. And it says that the Lord descended in a cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord declared, he said, the Lord God, merciful and gracious. What did Moses say? Show me your glory, and the glory of your Lord, the Lord, shall be thy reward. What's the glory? Merciful, gracious, long-suffering, abundant in goodness and truth, keeping keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity, transgression, and sin, that will in no wise pardon the guilty. Do you know, that's good news when people have suffered. That's the glory of the Lord. Let's take the merciful, gracious, long-suffering, abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands. Let's take that back into the fast. Isn't that the fast? To loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens. I find at the health retreat, many are burdened down with caffeine addictions, sugar addictions, alcohol addictions, drug, tobacco addictions. That's why God wanted us to open health retreats. Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry? What does Jesus call himself? The bread of life. To deal thy bread to the hungry, to bring the poor that is cast out to thine house. Did you hear that? Your house. When thou seest the naked, that thou cover him, and that thou turn not thy face from thine own flesh. Do you know, my daughter told me a very sad story about a couple whose eldest daughter ran off and married another man. It is now 10 years later and they will not talk to that daughter. And you know what the grandparents said? Yeah, but you did that. You ran off together and married. How sad. We're not to turn our face from our own flesh. This lady has grandchildren and she has never seen them. And oh, how those grandchildren need to know from their grandmother words of life about a loving Saviour. Turn not thy face from thine own flesh. No wonder the psalm says, if thou, O Lord, shouldst mark iniquity, O Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with thee, that thou mayest be feared. That's Psalm 130. So what God says, is not this the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free, and that ye break every yoke? Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, to bring the poor that are cast out to thine house, when thou seest the naked that thou cover him, and turn not thy face from thine own flesh? Then shall thy light rise as the morning, and your health shall spring forth speedily. The glory of the Lord shall be thy reward. Then shalt thou call, and he will answer. Then shalt thou cry, and he will say, here I am. If thou put away from the midst of thee the yoke, the putting forth of the finger, and the speaking of vanities, then shall thy light rise in obscurity, and thy darkness shall be as the noonday. And they that shall be of thee shall build up the old waste places and shall raise the foundations of many generations. What's the fast? What's the fast? Is not this the fast that I have chosen? A physical fast is stopping food. No more food entering to my stomach. That's a fast. What's this fast? I would like to suggest that it's a fast from self. No wonder Ellen White says in page 43 of Steps to Christ, she said, the warfare against self is the greatest battle that has ever been fought. The yielding of self, the surrendering of all to the will of God requires a struggle. But the soul must submit to God before it can be renewed in holiness. When we submit to God, and how do we do that? And in page 47, she says, what we need to understand is the true force of the will. This is the governing power in the nature of man. It is the power of decision or of choice. The power of choice God gave to man, it is theirs to exercise. You cannot change your heart. You cannot of yourself give to God its affections, but you can choose to serve him. You can give him with your will. He will then work in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Your emotions now will be centered on him. Your thoughts will be in harmony with his thoughts. Through the right action of the will, an entire change can be made in the life. No wonder Jesus says, I stand at the door and knock, and if any man hear my voice and open the door, he says, I will come in and sup with him and he with me. That's the Saviour I want. You see, there's another power. And it's spoken about in 1 Peter 5, verse 7. It says, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, and he will exalt you in due season. casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. Be sober, be vigilant, knowing that your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeing whom he can devour, whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. Therefore, brethren, be steadfast in the faith. How do we be steadfast in the faith? It's by surrender. It's by surrender. It's by submitting your whole life to God. He will then come in you and work in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. And the final verse in 1 Peter says, but the God of all grace, who has called you unto his eternal glory. What's the eternal glory? Merciful, gracious, long-suffering, abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity, transgression and sin. But the God of all grace, who has called you unto his eternal glory, after that ye have suffered. It is not easy submitting your whole will to God. It is not easy surrendering self. But the God of all grace, who hath called you unto his eternal glory, after ye have suffered a while, establish, strengthen, settle you. That is the way to do it. It is the only way to do it. God has made provision. God has shown us the way. No wonder he says, this is the way, walk ye in it. But God is a gentleman. He will never force, not like the roaring lion. But what does God say? Whom resist? Steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. There are two polar opposites in our mind. One is faith and one is fear. From fear come all the negative emotions like grief, anxiety, discontent, remorse, guilt, distrust. And God has told us what to do with fear. In 2 Timothy 1 verse 7, God says, I have not given you the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. You see, a sound mind is the opposite to fear. What's the sound mind? Over here where faith is. And Hebrews 11 verse 1 says, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And faith grows strong by earnest conflict with fear and doubt. That's why the Bible says, whom resist, you go to battle. Don't let him in. Don't let him in. How do you go to battle? Let God do the battle for you. Where's the greatest battle ever fought? The surrendering of self. The yielding of self, the surrendering of all to the will of God requires a struggle. It is a struggle. But the soul must submit to God before it can be renewed in holiness. Faith and hope are inseparable companions. Hope sees the invisible, feels the intangible, and achieves the impossible. And Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ that strengtheneth me.